is from Mark chapter 4, verse 35 to chapter 5, verse 43. That day, when evening came, he said to his disciples, "Let us go over to the other side." Leaving the crowd behind, they took him along, just as he was, in the boat. There were also other boats with him. A furious squall came up, and the waves broke over the boat so that it was nearly swamped. Jesus was in the stern, sleeping on a cushion. The disciples woke him and said to him, "Teacher, don't you care if we drown?" He got up, rebuked the wind, and said to the waves, "Quiet, be still." Then the wind died down, and it was completely calm. He said to his disciples, "Why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith?" They were terrified and asked each other, "Who is this? Even the wind and the waves obey him." They went across the lake to the region of the Gerasenes. When Jesus got out of the boat, a man with an impure spirit came from the tombs to meet him. This man lived in the tombs, and no one could bind him anymore, not even with a chain. For he had often been chained hand and foot, but he tore the chains apart and broke the irons on his feet. No one was strong enough to subdue him. Night and day, among the tombs and in the hills, he would cry out and cut himself with stones. When he saw Jesus from a distance, he ran and fell on his knees in front of him. He shouted at the top of his voice, "What do you want with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? In God's name, don't torture me." For Jesus had said to him, "Come out of this man, you impure spirit." Then Jesus asked him, "What is your name?" "My name is Legion," he replied, "for we are many." And he begged Jesus again and again not to send them out of the area. A large herd of pigs was feeding on the nearby hillside, and the demons begged Jesus, "Send us among the pigs, allow us to go into them." He gave them permission, and the impure spirits came out and went into the pigs. The herd, about 2,000 in number, rushed down the steep bank into the lake and were drowned. Those tending the pigs ran off and reported this in the town and countryside, and the people went out to see what had happened. When they came to Jesus, they saw a man who had been possessed by the legion of demons, sitting there, dressed and in his right mind, and they were afraid. Those who had seen it told the people what had happened to the demon-possessed man and told about the pigs as well. Then the people began to plead with Jesus to leave their region. As Jesus was getting into the boat, the man who had been demon-possessed begged to go with him. Jesus did not let him, but said, "Go home to your own people and tell them how much the Lord has done for you and how he has had mercy on you." So the man went away and began to tell in the Decapolis how much Jesus had done for him, and all the people were amazed. When Jesus had again crossed over by boat to the other side of the lake, a large crowd gathered around him while he was by the lake. Then one of the synagogue leaders, named Jairus, came, and when he saw Jesus, he fell at his feet. He pleaded earnestly with him, "My little daughter is dying. Please come and put your hands on her so that she will be healed and live." So Jesus went with him. A large crowd followed and pressed around him. A woman was there who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years. She had suffered a great deal under the care of many doctors and had spent all she had. Yet instead of getting better, she grew worse. When she heard about Jesus, she came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak, because she thought, "If I just touch his clothes, I will be healed." Immediately her bleeding stopped, and she felt in her body that she was freed from her suffering. At once Jesus realized that power had gone out from him. He turned around in the crowd and asked, "Who touched my clothes?" "You see the people crowding against you," his disciples answered, "and yet you can ask, 'Who touched me?'" But Jesus kept looking around to see who had done it. Then the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came and fell at his feet and, trembling with fear, told him the whole truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace and be freed from your suffering." While Jesus was still speaking, some people came from the house of Jairus, the synagogue leader. "Your daughter is dead," they said. "Why bother the teacher anymore?" Overhearing what they said, Jesus told him, "Don't be afraid, just believe." He did not let anyone follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. When they came to the home of the synagogue leader, Jesus saw a commotion with people crying and wailing loudly. He went in and said to them, "Why all this commotion and wailing? The child is not dead, but asleep. But they laughed at him. After he put them all out, he took the child's father and mother and the disciples who were with him and went in where the child was. He took her by the hand and said to her, "Talitha kum," which means, "Little girl, I say to you, get up." Immediately, the girl stood up and began to walk around. She was 12 years old. At this, they were completely astonished. He gave strict orders not to let her know about this and told them to give her something to eat.
As far as we know, Mark never met Jesus. At least we are never told of any encounters between them. But according to the tradition, Mark was a frequent companion and assistant of the Apostle Peter. Thus, it has long been accepted that the foundation for the gospel that bears Mark's name is the preaching and memory of Peter himself. In other words, even though Peter never wrote an account of Jesus' life himself, at least none that have survived to this day, his memories of Jesus are largely preserved in the gospel story that Mark wrote. It makes sense. The rich detail in much of Mark's gospel can only be explained if it was provided by someone who was there. For example, in the passage of scripture that we just read, Mark tells that after Jesus brought the girl back to life, he told them to give her something to eat. It's a wonderful detail, but not really a key part of the story. The question then is how did Mark find out about it? Remember, only Jesus, Peter, James, John, and the parents of this little girl were present when she was brought back to life. Mark must have heard the story from one of them, or there is no way he could have known what Jesus had said. The same is true for a lot of other details in Mark's gospel. They are things that could be only known if someone was there. And so it makes sense that Mark would have gotten his information from Peter. So it is interesting to think about what it would have been like to be Mark. To sit with Peter, to hear his stories. Can you imagine what that would have been like? To actually hear about Jesus from someone like Peter? Someone who was there? Maybe it would have been something like this.
So Mark, did I ever tell you about the days that I really started to figure out just how great Jesus' power was? When it was that I began to understand what it meant to have faith in him? It didn't happen all at once, but there are a couple days that stand out as days where Jesus revealed a glimpse of his power. It started one night, after a day when Jesus had been teaching, we were in Capernaum, alongside the Sea of Galilee, where James and John and Andrew and I had stowed our boats. And Jesus had been teaching all day, and like usual, there are huge crowds gathered around him. They never seemed to be able to get enough of him, and we were always bugging Jesus to take some time for himself, to get away, to take a break, but he never listened. It was like he was drawn to the crowds, and the crowds were drawn to him. But on this night, he surprised us. He suggested that maybe we should get in the boats and go on over to the other side of the lake. Well, the other side of the lake was Gentile territory, the Gerasenes. To be honest with you, I had never set foot on the shore over there. But if it would help Jesus get a break, I was all for it. So we pushed our boats into the water, and we scrambled aboard, and we headed to the other side of the lake. It was a quiet evening, and I gotta tell you, it felt good to be out on the water again. I felt even better when I saw Jesus go to the back of the boat, and we kept a cushion there, and he laid down on it, and he fell asleep. And so there we were, out in the middle of the lake, in the middle of the night, and swapping fishing stories, when I started to notice a breeze coming up out of the south. Now, Mark, I fished that lake my entire life, and I can count on one hand the number of times that the wind came up after the sun had gone down. It was a storm, like the storms that come in late afternoon, only this one was worse, much, much worse. So we trimmed the sails, and we bent our backs to the oars, but it didn't do much good. The waves were crashing over the boat. We were being swamped. And so as we're bailing water and I'm trying to get people organized, I'm trying to keep myself in the boat, I thought I should check on Jesus. And so I turned to the back and I said, "Master, are you okay?" And I couldn't believe it. He was still asleep. I mean, here we are in one of the worst storms I've ever experienced, and Jesus is laying there with his head on a pillow like he's sleeping at his mother's house in Nazareth. Well, I'm not proud of it, Mark, but I snapped. I got the attention of some of the others, and we shook Jesus, and I said, "Don't you care? We're going to drown. How can you sleep?" I'll never forget it. Jesus woke up like he just had the best night's sleep of his life, and he looked around like he was surprised to see the storm, and then he just said a few words. He said, "Quiet. Be still." And just like that, it was quiet. It was still. And not just the wind, mind you, the waves too. The water was as calm as the water at the bottom of a well. I was so stunned I almost fell out of the boat. I'll never forget the look on Jesus' face. There was sadness in his eyes that he looked at us and he said, "Why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith?" And then he turned around and lay back down on his cushion and went back to sleep. And Mark, I'll be honest with you, I didn't understand the question. I mean, honestly, I was more scared then than I was during the storm. The rest of the way across the lake, we just kept staring at him and wondering, who is this man? I mean, it was something else when he healed my mother-in-law, but to command the wind and the waves to silence, that was incredible. And that was just the beginning of our journey. It's about daybreak when we got to the other side of the lake and we beached the boats and Jesus got up on the shore and we weren't sure why we were there. Jesus just stood there along the edge of the water looking up into the hills like he was waiting for somebody. We sat there in the boats and I started to hear a noise, something. It was unlike anything I've ever heard before. It was like a howling. Like a man screaming, only it was different. It was otherworldly. Some of the other guys were getting nervous. They were ready to shove the boats back into the water. And we just kept looking up into those hills. And then I saw him. It was a man coming down out of the hills. He was half naked. He had a chain around one wrist. And he was bruised and cut all over his body. And his hair was tangled. And his beard was a mess. And he's running down the hills towards Jesus. Obviously, this was a madman, and so I got up onto the shore, and I got in front of Jesus, because I wasn't going to let this wild man get to him, and Jesus just put his hand on my shoulder and pulled me back, and he stepped forward to meet this man, and as the wild man came closer, Jesus held up his hand, and the man fell to his knees, and he began to yell and scream at Jesus, and Jesus very calmly said, "Come out of him, you evil spirit." Now, at this point, we'd seen Jesus perform dozens of exorcisms. We'd seen him cast evil spirits out of all kinds of people, but this was different. When Jesus said that, instead of the man getting well, he seemed to get worse. His body convulsed on the ground, and he kept screaming at Jesus. And Jesus said again, very calmly, "What's your name?" And the man spoke, and it wasn't like a voice I'd ever heard before. It was like thousands of voices. And he said, "My name is Legion, for we're many." And then just like that, the spirits in this man began to beg and plead with Jesus to have mercy on them, to allow them to stay in the area. On a hill nearby, there was a herd of pigs, 2,000 or more of them. And the spirits begged for permission to go and enter into those pigs. And so Jesus, he dropped his hand. He said, "Very well. And just like that, the man's body relaxed. At the same time, I could hear the squealing. And I looked over in that herd of pigs, and they were running down the hill into the lake where they drowned. And it occurred to me that if those evil spirits had been allowed to continue to possess that man, it would not have been much longer before they did the same to him. Well, the rest of our group came ashore, and they started to tend to the man. James and John helped get the chain off his wrist. The ladies in our group began to treat his cuts and bruises, and the rest of us gathered enough clothes for him to be dressed appropriately. And the whole time, he couldn't stop talking as he told Jesus his story. He said, in the hills where we'd come ashore, just on the backside, there was a graveyard, a bunch of tombs. And for years now, the man said he had lived alone in those tombs. He said when he'd become possessed by these spirits, the people of his town had tried to subdue him, but nobody was strong enough. No chains were strong enough to hold him. And so they'd driven him out into this graveyard, and he'd lived there under possession of these evil spirits, making him wander the hills at night, screaming and cutting himself with stones. And as he told this story, I began to notice a crowd gathering. People were coming. I guess the men who'd been watching over the pigs went into town to tell the others what had happened. And so now the people were coming and they began to bunch up. But they weren't like the crowds back home. Instead of coming to meet Jesus and to get Jesus' attention, they hung back like they were afraid. I guess it unnerved them to see this man they knew to be wild sitting there so calmly talking with Jesus. And finally, a couple of the braver ones came forward and they asked Jesus to leave. And Jesus just shook his head sadly and he motioned for us to get back in our boats. And I helped the others shove their boats back into the water and I came back for mine, the one Jesus was riding in. And Jesus was still standing there on the shore talking to this man who'd been possessed by demons. And the man was begging Jesus to get in the boat and to come with us. And Jesus just kept shaking his head no. And the man insisted until finally Jesus said firmly, no, you need to go home. You need to go back to your family. You need to tell them what the Lord has done for you. Tell them how God has had mercy on you. And then Jesus and I got in the boat, and as we shoved off, the last I saw of that man, he was trying to get the attention of the other villagers to tell them what had happened. I got to tell you, Mark, a couple of years ago, I went back to that region, the Gerasenes, the 10 cities there, so I could preach the gospel of Jesus. And everybody I met already knew that story. Seems that man went to every town in his region and told anyone who would listen what Jesus the Nazarene had done for him. Well, if that wasn't enough excitement for a couple of days, when we got back to the other side of the lake, there were already people waiting for Jesus. And again, this crowd was different than the others. Instead of pushing their sick forward or clamoring for Jesus' attention, they all seemed to have their focus on one man. His name was Jairus. He was the leader of our synagogue. And he was obviously distraught. He'd found out that his 12-year-old daughter was sick. He'd gone to the doctors and they told him there was nothing they could do. They said that she was going to die. And so now he'd come to find Jesus. As Jesus stepped out of the boat and walked onto the shore, Jairus came and fell at his feet and pleaded with Jesus to come with him, to come touch his daughter, because he said, if you just touch her, I know she will be healed and she will live. And so Jesus said he would come. But the whole crowd came with us. As we began to walk towards Jairus' house, the crowd pressed down around Jesus. And the other disciples and I, we tried to make a ring to protect Jesus, but the people were just pushing and getting so close that instead of setting out quickly for Jairus' house, we moved along at the snail's pace of a mob. I could see the look of frustration and worry on Jairus' face, and yet Jesus was so calm and willing to go at whatever speed the crowd would allow him. Now, I don't know if you've ever been in a mob, Mark, but it's not much fun. People keep bumping into you and stepping on your toes and elbowing you in the gut. And it was worse for Jesus because everybody wanted to touch Jesus. And so they were all grabbing at his clothes and stuff. And then all of a sudden, Jesus stopped. And he turned around and he said in a loud voice, he said, "Who touched my clothes?" I didn't even understand the question. I mean, everybody was trying to touch Jesus. They were all grabbing at him. What did the other disciples say? "What do you mean, Jesus? How can you ask such a question?" But Jesus just stood there and he waited. Until finally, from the edge of the crowd, a woman came forward and she fell at Jesus' feet. And I could see she was shaking with fear. And Jesus waited patiently as she told her story. She had been suffering for 12 years, an issuance of blood that would not stop. She'd spent her life savings going to doctor after doctor, trying to be made well, but instead of getting better, she only got worse. The bleeding increased, the pain grew stronger, until finally one day she heard about Jesus and she became convinced that if she could just get close enough to Jesus to touch the edge of his robe, she could be made well. So that's what happened. As she saw the crowd passing by, she worked her way through the crowd until she got close enough to grasp the hem of his garment. And she said immediately she felt the pain leave her body. She knew the bleeding had stopped. But she was frightened. She didn't want Jesus to know that she had done that because under Jewish law, any woman who is bleeding is considered impure. And it's against the law for her to intentionally touch another person because if she would touch another person, then she'd make that person impure. And so she was terrified that Jesus would be angry with her. But Jesus wasn't angry. He said, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and suffer no more." And she got up with a look of relief on her face and joy at her healing, and she went on her way. The whole time that she was telling her story, I could see that Jairus was becoming more and more worried, more and more frustrated that Jesus wasn't moving faster. And so once the woman got up and left, Jairus pleaded with Jesus, "Now, can we hurry on to my house and my little girl?" But before we could even get started, two men came from Jairus' house and told him that it was too late. "Don't bother the teacher anymore," they said. "Your daughter has died." I could see Jairus fall to his knees and begin to weep. I could tell that he loved his daughter a great deal. But Jesus came and put his hand on his shoulder and said, "Don't be afraid. Just believe." And then he helped Jairus to his feet. And turning to the rest of us, he motioned for James and John and I to follow while the others would stay. And he said, "Now we will go to see to this little girl." I gotta tell you, Mark, I hate funerals. And this was a big one. I guess because Jairus was so important in the synagogue, the whole village had already gathered at his house to mourn the loss of the little girl. Professional mourners were there weeping and wailing, playing their flutes. It was so sad. And Jesus approached the crowd and he said to them, Why this carrying on? The little girl's not dead. She's just asleep." And they laughed at him. And then Jesus put them out of their house, told everyone to leave, and taking the girl's parents and James and John and I, Jesus entered the house. And he went to where the little girl was. And it was so sad to see her laying there on her bed. 12-year-old girls, they're supposed to be out playing with their friends. They're supposed to be helping their mothers in the kitchen. They're not supposed to be lying dead on their beds in the middle of the afternoon. Behind me, I could hear the little girl's mother sobbing. And I looked at Jairus, and his face was white. And I looked at James and John, and they were shifting from heel to heel like they'd rather be any place but there. And Jesus went up to the little girl, and he took her by the hand. And he leaned over and he whispered to her in Aramaic. He said, "Talitha kum," which means, "Little girl, I say to you, get up." And her eyes opened. And her body drew in a breath. And before you knew it, she was standing up and she was walking around. Now the mother's girl was crying, but now they were sobs of joy. And Jairus was saying, thank you, thank you, thank you. And I looked at James and John, and they had looks of bewilderment on their face. And I suppose I looked the same. And Jesus was still calm. And he said that maybe it would be for the best if we didn't tell too many people about this for a while. And then even as the rest of us were trying to figure out what was going on, Jesus suggested that maybe the little girl might be hungry. Mark, I'd like to tell you that it all made sense to me after that, but I can't. I mean, I think it was after those 2 days that I really began to believe that Jesus was the Messiah, that he really was the Son of God. But I still didn't comprehend what that meant. I still didn't understand that question he asked us in the boat when he said, why are you afraid? Do you still have no faith? It wasn't until later, after he had been crucified and then resurrected, that I started to understand what it meant to follow him. It was then when I understood that it was who he was and what he'd done that meant I didn't have to go through life afraid. Because you see, Mark, I didn't get that yet. I was still afraid. I was still scared. That's why I attacked that soldier in the garden that night. That's why I denied knowing Jesus in the high priest's courtyard. It's because I was defensive. I was afraid of what was going to happen to me. And it wasn't until later, after I saw Jesus, after the resurrection, that I remembered the question that he asked me on the boat, and I understood that if I had faith in Jesus, that if I put my trust in him, then I didn't need to be afraid anymore. Jesus said to the bleeding woman, he said, your faith has made you well. She was afraid. She's afraid that Jesus would be angry because maybe she'd made him impure, but Jesus said, go in peace. Her faith was the antidote to her fear. And Jairus was afraid. He was afraid he'd never see his little girl again. And Jesus said, replace your fear with belief. Faith drives out fear. And you see, the question he asked us in the boat that night, that was the same. He was saying to us the same thing he said to Jairus. He was saying, don't be afraid. Just believe. And what he did for us in the boat that night was the same thing he did for that demon-possessed man and for that bleeding woman and for Jairus' daughter. He took something that we're scared of, something sinister like a storm or evil or sickness or death, and he showed that he is in control of even those things. If we have faith in him, then we don't need to be afraid. And Mark, when Jesus died on the cross and then when he rose again, he was saying the same thing to the entire world. He's saying that his power was greater than all the sinister powers of the world. If we have faith in him, we don't need to be afraid. Mark, it's like this. I mean, imagine you're walking along a hillside one day and your foot slips and you begin to fall down that hill. And imagine as you're sliding down that hill that there's a branch there sticking out of the side of the cliff. Now, how great does your faith need to be in that branch in order for it to save you? I mean, how sure do you need to be that that branch is going to hold you up? Not much, right? I mean, all you need to do is have a faith enough to grab hold, right? Just reach out and grab it because it's not the quality of your faith that's going to make a difference. It's the object you're putting your faith in. If you reach out and you grab onto that branch and you find that it holds your weight, then you know you're safe. Well, Mark, Jesus is the branch. And Jesus is the one who commands winds and waves to silence. He's the one who drives demons out. He's the one who heals sickness with a word. He's the one who brings the dead back to life. So, Mark, all you need to do is you need to reach out and grab hold of him. I'll never forget that night that we sailed to the Gerasenes and what happened after. That's when I began to see just how great Jesus' power really is. But I'll also never forget the lesson he taught us that day. Don't be afraid. Just believe. We have a team of folks that will be leaving for Haiti this week, Tuesday night, Wednesday morning. So we want to encourage you to remember them in your prayers through the week. There will be some email updates as they come in. But also this morning, we're going to have Sunday school. It's going to start here like normal, but we're going to abbreviate it a little bit, about 10:15, 10:20. We're going to gather down in the harbor, and we're going to have a prayer service and a chance to wish them well. So I want to encourage you to hang around. The team will be down in the harbor here in just the next few minutes. You can go make some small talk with them, and there are going to be some refreshments as well. And then the Sunday school classes will come up at about 10:15, and we'll have that prayer send-off for them. As you go, may the Lord bless you, and may the Lord keep you. May the Lord make His face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up His countenance upon you and give you His peace. Even so, Maranatha, come quickly, Lord Jesus. Amen.